evening, everybody. Welcome. My name is Peter Steves. It's my privilege to be the director of the DePaul Humanities Center. I'm pleased to welcome you to another installment in our year-long transformations-themed programming series, as tonight we think together about clowns, jesters, and tricksters. But we begin first by acknowledging the traditional territory upon which we gathered this evening. Long before Europeans arrived, varied and numerous native people sought to walk gently on this land. They offered assistance to the first European travelers to this territory, sharing their knowledge for survival and living a good life. Among others, the Potawatomi, Ojibwe, Miami, and Illinois inhabited what is now this part of Chicago. While we here today have no power to honor the treaties that were signed, we do recognize that these treaties were brokered under some duress and deception. So it's our hope tonight to honor the good faith with which the native people of the region entered into these treaties. As Potawatomi Chief Matea is purported to have said at the signing of the 1821 Treaty of Chicago, quote, "This is a small piece of land, and if we give it away, what will become of us? The Great Spirit, who has provided it for our use, allows us to keep it. We should incur his anger if we bartered it away. If we had more land, you should get more. But our land has been wasting away ever since the white people became our neighbors, and we now have hardly enough to cover the bones of our tribe." End quote. In solidarity with Chief Matea, we recognize the history and legacy of this subjugation, as well as the enduring presence today of Native Americans among our faculty, staff, student body, and community. And it's thus that we seek a new relationship with the original peoples of this land, one based on honor and true respect. So, for those of you who are joining us at the DePaul Humanities Center tonight for the first time, welcome. And for those of you who are returning guests, we're glad to have you back. If you happen to fall into that latter camp, perhaps you were with us a few weeks ago for our Humanities in Space series, when we looked at the moon. And we learned that NASA has built a fancy restaurant up there. They say it has great food, but no atmosphere. Or perhaps you joined us for our investigation of orbits, where we heard the story about the man who stayed up all night wondering where the sun went, and then it dawned on him. Or maybe you were with us for another event in our transformation series this year, such as the appearance of Edward Watson, the greatest living male ballet dancer alive today, when we learned how many dance teachers it takes to screw in a light bulb. 5, 6, 7, 8. So, I can almost guarantee you that you'll hear nothing so silly the rest of the night. All of our guests are far cleverer than I am. But I thought it might be worth a few minutes before we get started in earnest to think together about the nature of humor, especially as it's related to the exposure of truth and the disruption of power. Throughout Western history, various philosophers have had theories of comedy. These investigations, however, are usually secondary to some other project. It's tragedy, not comedy, that is typically thought to be more important and to be more foundational in terms of our culture and our history. Tragedy supposedly instructs. Tragedy exposes the truths of fate and suffering. Tragedy, they say, is realism. Can I help you?
Democracy and I've lost. This is how I get to France.
You need to go north on the lakeshore.
That looks good.
Yeah. Democracy the clown, apparently. I don't think he's actually ever been home here since about 1492. Okay. Thank you, democracy. It's tragedy, not comedy, that's typically thought to be more important, to be more foundational in terms of our history and our culture. The idea is that tragedy instructs us. Tragedy exposes the truths of fate and suffering. Tragedy, that way, is realism. But comedy, although seldom taken as seriously, is, in my estimation, far more important. Comedy is not only capable of speaking the truth, it's also capable of problematizing what we mean by truth in the first place, and then showing us a solution to our problems rather than merely pointing them out. Now, Immanuel Kant's theory of comedy is, unsurprisingly, not very funny at all, given how dry and unfunny Kant's philosophy is. So here's what he tells us. Humor is when we put heterogeneous notions under common genera. In other words, when two things that apparently have nothing in common can be shown to have something that ties them together, that, Kant says, is hilarious. Puns work this way, showing that a single word actually has two very different meanings. So do jokes that turn on exposing truths, such as Dimitri Martin's claim that the great thing about the rise of digital cameras is that they allow us to reminisce instantly. Logos, rationality itself, sees technology as part of an ongoing process, a process that makes sense. It's common that points out the ridiculous failure of reason, the problem of nostalgia that was always already there from the start. Tragedy paints a picture of a world where reason and rationality control everything in an orderly unrolling of history, a world where suffering makes sense. There's no chance that Oedipus is headed toward anything other than the destiny that logic demands. The imperative that Macbeth follows is built into him like a natural law. Even the 20th century itself appears to unfold according to a cold and sterile rationality, inexorably passing through the trenches of World War I, the horrors of Auschwitz, the march of neoliberal capitalism, colonialism, and empire, as reason unfurls tragically. Comedy, though, can show us that none of this made sense to begin with, that there was and always is another way. It's not, then, that comedy is the better path toward truth, but that it calls into question the sterile Enlightenment conception of truth altogether. That sort of truth is founded on the law of non-contradiction, the idea that A and not A cannot both be true at the same time. Sometimes it takes a sense of humor to realize that this isn't the case. I'm reminded of the famous story of a logician and linguist who came to campus once, and in the course of his lecture, announced that two negatives always make a positive. For instance, if someone claims, "I can't disagree," she really means that she agrees. Pompous and full of himself, he then announces, "But of course, it's impossible that two positives have ever made a negative." At which point, someone in the back row yells out,
Yeah, right.
This is not just an instance of speaking truth to power. An example of how comedy can deconstruct the ideology of power at a fundamental level. Most of the horrors of tragedy are based on the pure logic of the law of non-contradiction and the dualisms that follow. Us, them, white, black, straight, gay, male, female, it's not only that these dichotomies falsely describe the world, but that their logic is such that the second term is defined by precisely not being the first term. What it means to be black, then, is to not be white. What it means to be female is to fail at being a man. Tragedy results from this sort of thinking, and the pure logic of Enlightenment thought cannot help. A good joke can point out that logic was problematic from the very start. Even laughter itself can mark the failure of the project. There's a long history, for instance, of claiming that women cannot be funny, that they have no sense of humor. Women are taught to suppress laughter, even. According to such scholars as Mary Daly Ann Beats and Frances Gray, men actually fear women's laughter, as if women have realized that the game can't be won because it was set up in the first place to keep them oppressed. Elaine Sixou reminds us that the Medusa, when we look at her clearly, is laughing, and that men are terrified to death by this, terrified to think that a woman could know she is not a man and still be happy, still feel empowered precisely as a woman. For a man, for the patriarchy, it doesn't get more irrational than that. Laughter, understood correctly, can be a revolutionary marker. Part of the challenge, though, is that the momentum of tragedy is great, and the status quo is always at the ready to co-opt any act of attempted subversion. It's far too easy to let the court jester, for instance, become a mere steam valve for those who are oppressed, something that lets us vent our frustration rather than let it build up to the explosive point of revolution and thus real change. It's far too easy merely to tune into John Oliver and then think we've done our duty, that xenophobia and patriarchy are now on the run. It's far too easy to post a meme on Facebook or retweet a pointed sentence, to laugh at the powers that be, and then think that those powers are instantly weakened. Comedy can be revolutionary, but it must be thoughtful in a pointed way, and it must be coupled with action that is then based on this revolution of thought. The smartest thing that comedy can do, though, and thus the hardest thing for it to do well, is to speak from the outside about the horrors of the status quo, while at the same time deconstructing the inside-outside dichotomy. After all, it's the belief in the dichotomy that makes the dichotomy real. It's the fact that we treat those in power as if they have power that truly affords them that power. Ethics and politics will only be about power at all if we accept the paradigm of power, if we accept that it's always a power game, if we accept that there are those outside the system with inherently less power who must find a way to gain power or perish. But what if the discourse of power itself is the problem? Power can never be in balance. It can never be stable. Power is always leading to tragedy eventually. This is why laughing at, or even with, an authority can be dangerous business. Getting at the institution of the jester, an institution that deconstructs the larger institutions of which it's a part. As Beatrice Otto, one of our guests this evening, argues, it's in the nature of jesters to speak their minds when the mood takes them, regardless of the consequences. They are neither calculating nor circumspect, and this may account for the foolishness often ascribed to them. They have little to gain by caution and little to lose by candor. They are peripheral to the game of politics. To this, I would only add that humor does not fit into the logic of instrumental reason, therefore. The jester jokes regardless of consequence, with no personal goal within the game of politics. The fact that the jester is employed by the court only suggests that there is something internal to the logic of power and class oppression that is already at work in the court, poisoning it, a small dose, an incalculable conflict and contradiction that plays itself out internally while breaking down the idea of the internal and the external. The jester, that is, shows another path, an alternative to the tragedy of reason. Or consider a trickster story from the native Tlingit in what is today Alaska that tells the story of Raven surviving through the winter by interacting with the local humans. The story goes that Raven encountered a community where the people were fishing, and he entered a house, greeting them as a neighbor, and asking them how exactly they were going about their task. "What do you use for bait?" asked Raven. "Only the richest fat," they responded. "Let me see how skillfully you bait those hooks," said Raven, his voice dripping with false flattery. And he watched them bait and handle their hooks. Praising them, he took his leave. And the following day when they went out to fish, Raven entered the water at a point far away, swam underwater to where the people were casting their hooks, and carefully removed the delicious fat for himself, knowing exactly how to do so without disturbing the lions. This story turns into a series of further complications, of course, with the humans stealing Raven's beak in retaliation, and Raven having to come up with some complicated scam to get it back, etc. But as Lewis Hyde correctly realizes, the point is simply that in the relationship between fish and fishermen, the trickster stands to the side and takes on another role, a third role, a role that doesn't fit with the first two. That is, what appears to be an eternal battle between two opposing forces, humans and fish, killer and prey, life and death. Turns out to be a dialectic deconstructed best by a con artist who isn't a part of their system, who appears to stand outside, but actually calls into question the notion that there ever was a stable inside, a stable binary in the first place. Or consider the clown. It's generally accepted that there are three modern types of clowns: the white-faced clown, so named for the whole of the face being covered in white makeup; the august clown, whose face is usually pink, tan, or red, and whose features are outlined and exaggerated in size; and the hobo clown, who traditionally has makeup representing an unshaven face with white around the mouth and eyes. Emmett Kelly is perhaps single-handedly responsible for making the hobo clown a staple of the last century, having switched from his white-faced clown trapeze artist character to a hobo clown he had developed in 1921, and then started playing regularly 10 years later. But the roots of the hobo clown go even deeper. Leo Bassi argues that clown costumes have their origin in pauper dress, in the dress of the lower class, who cannot afford tailored clothing, and thus often dressed in mismatched and oversized clothing. As costumes began being designed especially for professional clowns, the choice to continue with the pauper look was a social political commitment. The choice to dress this way, and to find it as a source of joy, to present such clothing as something worth wearing and worth smiling about, that was a sort of anarchic nonconformity. It was to say that what had been forced on some was now a freely chosen act, and that this choice was now a marker of freedom in general that removed itself from the economic constraints of the state. In fact, the clown's oversized and ill-fitting garb went on to have a feedback loop relationship with the culture at large in the 20th century, especially with those most marginalized. Consider a bit of history we seldom talk about. In the early 1930s, the US government deported nearly half of the people living in the country who were of Mexican descent. That included 1.2 million legal US citizens, people just arrested in their homes and shipped off to Mexico. The sentiment was that the Great Depression was limiting jobs and reducing resources all over. And so, white America decided to make the country great again by reducing competition for whites. 10 years later, 3 million Mexican Americans lived in the US, with Los Angeles being the area with the highest concentration. Here, Latinos lived in the oldest parts of town, in ghetto conditions, working jobs that kept them below the poverty level while facing daily harassment from the police. With the outbreak of World War II, patriotism within the mainstream white culture began taking new forms. Austerity and rationing were promoted as national goods that would support the state by supporting the troops. Fabric rationing was a part of this new patriotism. Save cloth for the men of the armed forces, Americans were told. By 1942, the US War Production Board regulated the manufacturing of men's suits, creating a new politicized aesthetic of streamlined clothing meant to result in a 26% reduction of the use of cloth among the citizens. And in response, young Latinos, especially in Los Angeles and other parts of California, began boldly wearing suits with an excess of fabric. Long jackets, baggy pants, exaggerated and oversized accessories such as platform shoes and long watch chains. They became the zoot suit subculture, with black market tailors and young Latino men seeing the use of excessive fabric as a moral stance against the state. African Americans began following suit, so to speak, as well. In 1943, the Zoot Suit riots took place, with white sailors and policemen taking to the streets and beating men and women of color with what one journalist at the time called, quote, a sadistic frenzy over clothing. A young Malcolm X and Cesar Chavez were among those who wore Zoot Suits and were inspired to continue to see the way that they dressed as being, in part, a political act. The clown's choice to affirm and celebrate the excessive, oversized outfit that mainstream culture might see as sloppy or immoral thus marked a way for those who were considered outside the main power structure not to try to gain access to that power, but to affirm their own aesthetic and demand that they themselves construct the conditions for their own happiness. One could even see the development in the 1990s of hip-hop culture adopting baggy shirts and low-hanging pants as part of this ongoing feedback loop of resistance. Pants that are about to fall down, whether on a clown or on another marginalized member of society who demands to find his or her joy outside of the system, this can be a sign of resistance. So, I don't pretend to speak on behalf of all our guests this evening, but it seems to me that we must find it useful to think of the jester, the trickster, and the clown as the sorts of liminal characters who do not merely live on the outskirts of the mainstream, but call into question the legitimacy of the very border they appear to inhabit. Together, they suggest that we have been willing to equate tragedy and realism for far too long. Perhaps what it means to be realistic is not to accept the way things are and thus accept the structures that oppress us. Perhaps what it means to be realistic is to laugh, to see the artistic skills of the jester, trickster, and clown as the highest forms of art to which we might aspire, and even to see the fact that we exist at all as deeply, truly, and incomprehensibly funny. But hey, enough of my yakking. What do you say? Let's boogie. In 1992, Bonzo Crunch attended Ringling Brothers Barnum Bailey's Clown College, graduating and touring with the Red Unit of the Greatest Show on Earth during 1993 and 94. 10 years later, Bonzo returned to Ringling Brothers to serve as Goodwill Ambassador, or Advance Clown, one of the most prestigious positions in the circus. He's delighted audiences around the world, and today we're lucky that the circus has come to town and has led him here to DePaul for one night only. Ladies and gentlemen, children of all ages, put your hands together for Bonzo Crunch!
They get so stuck, it almost looked like they were stuck, like they stuck. Uh-oh. That can't happen. Do you know why that can't happen? It can't happen because that is impossible. Now, I think I figured it out. You want to know the secret? I'll show you. The secret is that every one of these has a soft spot. Sometimes it's over here. Sometimes it's over here. It's usually right here in the corner. But If you rub yourself, thoughts together. This has happened to you, hasn't it, sir? tell you what. If this ever happens to you, all you have to do is go like this. Slide it to the end. It'll go flying through the air, and the nice man in the glasses in the far corner is going to catch, right? You ready? When I count to three, he's going to catch. One, two, three, stop! One more time. One, two, three. Well, these two are supposed to look just like... Wait a minute. Oh, okay, folks, you know what? I can straighten everything out. Okay, I'll leave the jokes for Colbert. Let's see. We got a mess, don't we? Let's take all four hangers and make them all go three on one. Or, even more amazing, one on three. Okay, not so amazing, but I'll tell you what. How about if I take a hanger? Maybe if I can take one hanger and hit the end very hard, maybe I can make it come loose. No. Wait a minute. One down, two to go. Now let's see if we can get all three hangers loose, just like so. There we go. Wait a minute. Let's be very careful. Ooh, like the wings of a butterfly, like a twinkling star, they part. Like dreams upon a... Oh, my bad. They're backwards. There we go. Like the wings of a butterfly, like a twinkling star, they part like dreams upon a... I think I'm in trouble. I might need some help. Look, do you guys believe in magic? Do you believe in magic? You do? What are they teaching you here? Magic is a stage illusion. But I'll tell you what, that makes my job easy. Everybody put your hand in the air, roll it around, and say, abracadabra. All together. Abracadabra. Awesome. Now, when I count to three, you will engage in magic, and we will say, abracadabra. Oh, wait, like the wings of a butterfly, like a twinkling star. One, two, three. Abracadabra. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. And now I have a question. Let me see. You folks, you all like card tricks? You all like card tricks? Tell you what, would you like to see a card trick? Well, if I ever learn one, you'll be the first to know. But, you know, what I would like to do, I would like to present a musical accompaniment. I would like to take my homuncula and accompany with my voice. But that's not so easy to do. So, I have two musical assistants. Allow me to introduce the band. Over here is one. Our friend Uncle Junior and his nephew, Okay. And together we are the one, the only Pink Floyd. Now, it's not my joke, it's rented. Now here we go. A one, a two, a one, two, hit it, boys. And now, my friends, it has come time for me to bid you fondue. I will let you put the boys away over here. And I have to say, it has been a pleasure being here. Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure being had. And I'll see you the next time I look at you. Toodaloo. You're too kind. You're way too kind. And that's why I like you. Okay. Thank you. I bid you fondue.
Back to talk to us in a little while, but before that, our next presenter tonight. Margaret Noden received an MFA in creative writing and a PhD in English and linguistics from the University of Minnesota. She is currently an associate professor at the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee, where she also serves as the director of the Electa Quinney Institute for American Indian Education. She's the author of Bawajimo, a dialect of dreams in Anishinaabe language and literature, and Wewini, a collection of bilingual poems in Ojibwe and English. Her poems and essays have been published in Sing, Poetry from the Indigenous Americas, Poetry Magazine, the Michigan Quarterly Review, Waterstone Review, and Yellow Medicine Review. As the Swamp Singers, she and her daughters comprise a woman's hand drum group whose lyrics are all in Ojibwe. We're incredibly fortunate to have her with us tonight. Please join me in welcoming Margaret Noden.
Buju, being a language teacher, I guess I should ask that you learn some language, and since you are in Chicago, which for us means skunk, you might as well learn to speak the language of your city, right? So you can say buju back, that's hello. So buju. You didn't know you'd have to wear noses and speak other languages, perhaps. I think, you know, it fits with the way the evening is going if I skip to the end and then start over so that I don't run out of time. Oops, let me make sure I'm on the right one. So, what I want to do, and it's always interesting, you have a plan, and then you encounter everyone else you're speaking with, and you maybe revise the plan. What I wanted to do was just give you some sense of the sound of this place, of the Great Lakes, and the way that we would disturb it, the way that we would use humor and our words for humor to cause little disturbances that make us see things differently. So it fits maybe differently than the other talks, but I think in a way it does fit. So I'll start with this, because the one thing I would want you all to go home saying is that you have heard some of the language of Chicago, Wisconsin, Michigan. These are all names in our language, and they all mean things to us. And I think that when people get a little piece of that back, it's always very nice. So the poems that I write, they're sort of poems, they're sort of songs. What I try to do is play with the language so that people hear it. Because our language is not used as much as it once was, just using it is a bit of an act of defiance, and just putting it out there in the world is something different. So I'll put this one out there for you, and you can follow along and read the English. But the point of this one in particular is about the way stories get us to think differently, and how sometimes stories amuse us, but then sometimes stories mean different things to us. Yeah, can you hear me well enough? Is that good? Maybe. Is it better now? I don't know. Hopefully it's okay. I'm going to trust that you'll gesture, because I can't really see most of you, but I can see you, so okay. The other thing is, with these, I usually write them to sing them, so I don't want to do that loud, so we'll try and make sure it works for you. This one is called Wawindamojik, and Wawindamo is to tell someone something, but the way that you do it, if you do it with a bit of forgetting, then it becomes a promise. So there are ways that in the English definition, concepts get tangled. So the difference between telling something and forgetting something is a pretty thin line. Now one. the one, Anishinaabe, which is basically a little story about how the stories we tell can be unpredictable to us. And just to give you some context that perhaps fits with what the other folks are saying, these are the ways that we talk about tricksters or clowns. There are over 565 federally recognized nations still in the US, and darned if we don't all have completely different traditions. So I can really only speak for the Anishinaabe, the language that I speak, the culture that I represent. I can't really speak for all the rest of the clowns, but there are things in particular that have patterns that ripple across the traditions of the continent. So raven as a trickster is one. Wolf and spider are often seen as tricksters. The idea that you have someone who destabilizes things, who can be between worlds and teach you that the past and present can exist together, that the binary isn't so concrete and absolute as you might imagine, those things we do all have. But these four concepts here, Giba Denim, Minchikane, or Mikinazom, Bapananim, and Waeje, those are as close as we can get to talking about humor. We don't have an exact equation for that. But basically, Giba Denim is it borders on being crazy or making someone else crazy. So humor is a little bit of having some of that craziness yourself or passing that along. And the Mikinaje or Mikinazom is to run along a spectrum of a little trick, maybe just a card trick, maybe just a little joke, all the way up to really truly provoking someone. So again, it's a bit of a spectrum. It's something that isn't as concrete or black and white as we might want. And Bapananim is make someone laugh. Same thing, this word also has a spectrum and it can go right up to actually ridiculing. So we would teach children not to do this to one another, but you can't stop children from laughing. The thing to learn is where is the line? When have you gone too far? And then waeje is a word that is probably my favorite out of all of these ways to say trickster or humor. And that is to trick or to fool or seduce or deceive. So that's a pretty big range. That word can be implied when you're doing any one of those things. So the trickery that might come from, say, a raven or our trickster, Wenabuju, when you're actually learning a lesson, all the way up to the trickery you might use to manipulate or seduce or get someone to do what you want, or remember you forever, or whatever you're up to, right down to the things that we might say politicians use to absolutely deceive or to provide alternative facts, things like that. You know, we've mentioned how we might be outside of rules, outside of politics, and I think these tricksters were just that. I listed along the bottom as well some of the tricksters that are really common for us. So Wenabuju, also known as Nanabuju, is a trickster right around this area. And one of the things that Wenabuju did was provide balance to the Mishapishu, which people living in Chicago ought to know, the great underwater panther, who often takes the form of a riptide, sort of a panther with horns and a long tail, a very dangerous creature. And only Wenabuju could come along and destabilize the power of that creature. So there's many, many stories about the two of them battling it out along the shores, especially of Lake Michigan. And then Pukwis, Jisakaniniwuk, Makwa Bemoset, Painsa, these are all characters that we have. Some of them are a little bit like jesters. Some of them, the Painsa, are little tricky people. A little bit like gnomes, elves, leprechauns, ones who appear are not quite human, but not quite animal either. They've got characteristics that make them seem very, very human, but they're smaller in stature. They appear only to some people, not to everyone. And they're always trying to destabilize people's understanding. So these are the terms that might be familiar around here. And then the other thing that I'll share, just the ways that I try to put these ideas into my poems, partly because for us, in our language now, we have, they say, you know, we kind of reckon that we have several thousand speakers remaining. But, you know, to be very honest, I only know a handful, under 20, that are proficient speakers. And I can think of 6 or 7 of my teachers that I've had that we've lost in the last year. So very realistically, do we think this language will be spoken here in even one more generation? Statistically, there's no reason we should believe that. And yet, we still speak, and we still use it, and we sing, and we write, and we try to use the language creatively, because if we don't do that, the minute we stop, it is gone. So teetering on that brink of not being in use to being a sleeping language versus being a living, vibrant language, we try to do what we can. So this is a poem that I wrote about Jim Northrup, who was, I think, one of the great recent tricksters. We lost him actually last August, but he was someone who wrote hilarious stories and got people to think differently about very serious subjects. So this one is called Teasing Shakery. Mikkanindisi bapiwinat, chibinashi bap debajimo, bapijimo. Ejinime wat andego gashkendam zigwam. Eji kiduan noshkanachiganak nibing. Ejimikwana shimaganishak dugwagin. Ni dash kenowangiat anishinaabweadazokeam bibum. So if you are interested in local trickster storytellers besides the one that you have right here on your campus, Mark Turcott, who it's too dark for me to know if he's here, then maybe he is one of those shapeshifters that could be here even when we don't see him. If you haven't read his poetry, you should definitely look at his poetry and enjoy his presence here on your campus. But then there are others in our sort of Anishinaabe landscape as well. So Gordon Henry, but also Jim Northrup here, are really incredible storytellers. And maybe then I'll leave you with this one as well, just to kind of get to the point where we all compare each other's views and share our different ways of being in the world. This is, I think, one that I wanted to share because it takes in those ideas of being in a world that isn't defined in the same way as the world around us. So we try not to think that we're constantly up against the majority. For us, it gets pretty hard because we're, in fact, the minority. So when things get black and white, we are often still even not visible. So working against that, it could get very tiring to always be up against kind of the machine. So we just try to be in our own world. So this is one that comes out of that idea about being in the world differently, in a woodland kind of a way, in an Anishinaabe linguistic way. And finding a joyful life, finding humor and delight in the world that's around us. Api manado gizis soms basangwabi gaye gawin baji a ansinan gebe marge anmo duabi avanik mi mikwendaman odemene gizis misquewit misquasaget gizigon dagwagin api wabozok zagi agwa Idash gawin de viviasiok, apajanzo adoeum, wawashkeswe mikwenmok, zigbedom siwin ge gidakokasnet. Wen panat gwekwendamong, jabwium, bokesbium, zinagat gwenbium, aquavium, bokegaboeum, jimikamong eje jimikmazium. And that one I'll just give you in English as well, in case you were just listening and not reading along. When the sky's eye blinks in December, and I can't spear one of the thoughts swimming past the ice hole, I think of the strawberry moonlight bleeding across a long summer day. When I fall in love with autumn rabbits but can't hold them close enough, and all our fur is the wrong color, I think of deer woman drinking rivers to make spotted fawns. It's easy to change our minds, to look through a window, fall into a lake. It's harder to quit, to wait, or step off the main path to discover a joyful life. So maybe I will leave you with that and continue our unusual evening. Thanks for listening.
Thank you very much, Margaret. We'll have a chance at the end to have a discussion together and to get some questions from you as well. So we're looking forward to that. Next up, Rick Gern is Bonzo Crunch's good friend, though they've strangely never been seen together in the same place at the same time. Rick really has an amazing story as an entertainer, one that more or less begins in the late 1970s here in Chicago when he joined Vagabond Clowns and received their First of May award. Rick's interest in physical theater soon led him to join the Opus Mime Ensemble, where he toured Chicago schools performing a blend of gymnastics and mime as part of the Urban Gateways program. After studying at the Del Arte School of Mime and Comedy, Rick spent time performing in Australia. Returning to Chicago, he was regularly utilized by the Mayor's Office of Special Events, before once again heading off to study his craft, this time at Ringling Brothers Barnum & Bailey's Clown College. And these are just a few of the highlights of this celebrated performer. Joining us tonight from Austin, Texas, I'm pleased to introduce to you Rick Gern.
Well, hello. It's good to see y'all. I feel a little different now. I'd like to tell you a little bit about my approach to clowning, but the first thing I'd have to say is that it's by no means every clown's approach. One thing I learned in the Ringling Circus is that people come into this profession from all sorts of backgrounds, from all sorts of motives, and all sorts of reasons. As we were saying earlier, I've been doing this for about 40 years. I left college to do this, and for the first year of college, I was in Chicago, and I treated the city as my university. I took classes. I took a gymnastics class. I found a student of Marcel Marceau who was teaching mime. I took that. I went to the suburbs twice a week to take ballet with bored suburban housewives. And I went to Gary, Indiana once a week. There was a Chicago policeman who was a cop who taught a class in Gary, and I'd meet him at the precinct house and go down there. So I kind of pulled together an education as best I could until I had a chance to get a more formal education, first at the Del Arte School and then at Ringling Brothers. I'm not of a theoretical approach to what I do. my motto is, if they laugh, it's funny. And so I had, at one point, when I was at the Del Arte School, we were encouraged to have a message, to go out and have our performing be a sort of educational thing for the communities we went into and to better the people and everything. And I realized I was like a 24-year-old guy who hadn't had a lot of life experience, just the average person of average intelligence. I didn't really have a lot to teach. So I tried to be theoretical, and at one point I thought, my clown is going to be the everyman, or it will represent the plasticity of modern post-industrial society. And I had a lot of ideas about what it was, and one of the best pieces of advice I ever got was from my ex-wife, who listened patiently to me pontificating about what my clowning meant, and then she looked at me, she had no theater background, she had an MBA from the University of Chicago, and she said, what's wrong with just being a clown? And kind of the stone was lifted from my chest, and it's like, what's wrong indeed? So my approach is, I like kids, I like the sound of children's laughter, and I like being a children's and family entertainer because it's one of the few opportunities to entertain three or four generations at once. A lot of entertainment now, the bean counters have sliced and diced every demographic so finely that it's hard for people to share a lot of what they like. When I first left college to try doing this, I tried my hand at stand-up comedy. So by night, I would do the open mic at Zany's and some of these clubs. And then I was also working with a local clown group, and my first shows were in parades. And I remember very quickly realizing I like the clown audiences better than I like the nightclub audiences. I liked grandparents and children and teenagers and parents. I didn't particularly like young professionals drunk. That's just my taste. So I have a very approach. My approach is, this is a two-way mirror. Yes, I have my ego, and I want people to like me, I want them to laugh at me, but I also get to look back from the other side. And I like to pick the venues where I like what I see. So being in the circus was wonderful. It allowed me to travel the country, see 95 cities in 2 years, live on a train with people from all over the world. It was this crazy, rambling structure that always seemed like it was about to fall apart, but somehow held together. And there was, like I said, just the theme of our tour, in fact, was called Children of the Rainbow. Half the cast was children. And I think I remember them saying there was something like 90 countries represented or something. So it was this great way to, you get up and you get your rocks off and everyone laughs at you, but you also got to see a lot. And now being what's called a hometown clown, it's similar, but I don't do it in motion. Within one city, now it's Austin, Texas, I get to be welcome in the neighborhoods and homes of people from all sorts of backgrounds, rich, poor, every religious, every ethnic background, places where as me, I wouldn't have any business being there. But as Bonzo Crunch, I'm a welcome guest in people's homes. And I guess what sociologists would call being a participant observer. I get to be part of people's celebrations, part of their festivities, and I get to see the nicest common denominator of people, not the lowest. And what I find is that it's not everybody, literally, but statistically in general, everybody loves their kids. You see all these cultures, and everybody's got different ways of educating their children, different ways of doing things. But it gives me pleasure to see how, you know, like I say, it's the nicest common denominator. So that's sort of my approach. It's not very theoretical. It's to create a memory, a happy memory. I see children and I don't know that their lives are gonna be happy. I don't know what their lives are gonna be, but I wanna be able to feel that whatever their life is, there was some moment of pleasure and happiness that I could give them. In fact, one of the most gratifying moments, I've had this happen a couple times, is I've had a couple of young women, teenage mothers, who've hired me to do their children's party. And I've heard this story about 3 times where they said, I'm hiring you because you were at my birthday when I was a little girl, and you're one of the only happy things I remember from being a kid, and I want to give that to my kid. So it's not really a grand educational mission, but it's kind of just spreading a little kindness to people, things like that, I guess. It also lets kids know that you can grow up without really being grown up. I mean, you can still have a sense of fun. I can be an adult. I can, I can do the responsible things, but I can also be spontaneous. I can have fun. I don't have to be so serious. And hopefully that's a beneficently subversive little message I can give them. One of the themes here is jesters, and so I thought I'd relay a few incidents of where I got to play the role of the court jester. Before he was president, George Bush was governor of Texas, and I had several experiences performing at the governor's mansion. And I guess in my own little way, had a chance to speak truth to power. The first time was at an Easter party. It was an Easter egg roll, and I went there, and I was just contracted for an hour to a show and to make some balloons for the kids. Well, it's hard to just stay there for a half an hour when there's about 100 kids. So I ended up staying just about all day making balloons for them. But I got to overhear, this was the state legislature. It was the legislature and their kids. And I got to be a fly on the wall and hear some very unusual conversations. There was, and it sounds like I'm making this up, but it's true. There was a portly southern gentleman in a seersucker suit, and his name was like Jimmy Bob or something like that, one of these classic things. And he was talking to another fellow, and the guy said, well, Jimmy Bob, how have you been, Jimmy Bob? And he says, I've been good, Ray. He says, let me tell you, I had a talk with the Lord. And I think the Lord is smiling upon me because my stock portfolio is looking very good right now. And I thought, wow, okay. So Jesus picks blue chip stocks, and this guy is on the inside. So I was hearing conversations like that, and I had all that in mind when I got to meet the governor. I was, like I said, making balloons for the kids, but I couldn't give them a lot of choices because there were so many kids in so little time. So I said, at Easter, I'm making Easter bunnies. And one of the kids goes, can you make me a sword? I said, no. Weapon-free zone here. No weapons in the governor's mansion. And so I made him an Easter bunny. And then I see the kid, there's a bunch of grown-up men in suits talking, and this little boy comes up and he hands the balloon to one of the adults, and I see this grown man taking the balloon apart and then bending it all around. And the guy starts walking towards me, and he's got this bent balloon, and it's Governor Bush. And he says, "Can you turn this balloon into a sword?" And I've been thinking about the conversations I heard earlier, so I'm not going to deny the governor. I twist it into a sword. I said, "Yes, sir, I can turn this balloon into a sword if you can turn this sword into a plowshare." And he looked at me like X-ray vision, like, who's behind that makeup? And I noticed that he kept staring at me. When the kids' room was gone, he comes up and he squeezes my elbow and goes, "Mr. Clown, I want you to know you're doing a good job and you're earning your money." And I said, "Earning fiscal praise from a Republican, can I put that on my resume?" And the last time I saw him was after the election, but before the Supreme Court put him in office. And so there was heightened security, things were a lot different. And this was the Christmas party, and I was the Christmas elf. And I had a big sack full of toys, little giveaways for the kids. And I burst in and I said, "Got some votes for you from Florida, Mr. Governor." And Mrs. Bush, I think, wanted to kill me when I said that. She gave me some evil eyes. But that was my little experience being able to, as they say, tell truth to power. And had a few private moments with them and asked him, "How are you handling the tension?" And we were alone in the dessert room with all these cookies. And he was biting a sugar cookie. And he was, "Well, let me tell you, Mr. Clown, a lot of people don't want me to be president. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to grit my teeth and smile." Now think about that. Everybody grit your teeth. And smile. It doesn't quite go together. "I'm going to grit my teeth and smile, and I'm going to be president." And that was my last encounter with him. But that was my little role as the court jester. Otherwise, pretty much what I do is simple. It's, like I say, just be nice to kids. I mean, it sounds simple, but they need it. They need love. They need people to know that they're loved. I have three or four little aphorisms, I guess you'd say, that have been the things that sort of guide me. One, as I say, my ex-wife's, "What's wrong with just being a clown?" Another little bit of wisdom that I've tried to keep with me, when I was in clown college with Ringling Brothers, Chuck Jones, the animator of Bugs Bunny and a lot of those cartoons, he was a good friend of the dean of clown college, and he gave us a lecture on characterism, you know, the comedy as character-based, like the commedia dell'arte characters were all very strong, archetypal characters, and a lot of the cartoon characters, you could say they got their humor from representing the seven deadly sins. They embody one of those, and it's funny. And Chuck Jones' advice was, take your work seriously, but not yourself. I think that's good for not just humorists and clowns, but probably pretty good advice for most anybody. When I first started clowning, I joined a group called Clowns of America. It was a local group. I wasn't real happy with it. I'm not a joiner. I'm not a group person. But I stayed with it for a second year because I liked the motto on the card. It said, "No clown ever stood so tall that he couldn't stoop to look into the eyes of a small child." I thought, that's worth keeping in my wallet. And I kept that in my wallet until it fell apart. And the last little bit of advice that I try to keep with me was a fortune cookie that I still have over my desk. And it simply says, there is no wisdom greater than kindness. So that's my approach. Others may vary, but that's where I come from with my clowning. So, and we can talk. If you have questions, we'll talk later.
Okay. Thanks so much, Rick. Finally, it turns out that when you go looking for thoughtful research about the history and meaning of jesters, all roads lead to Beatrice Otto. If another scholar even mentions the topic today, he or she makes reference to Otto, deferring to her definitive and award-winning study, Fools Are Everywhere, The Court Jester Around the World, published by the University of Chicago Press in 2001 and available for sale outside in the foyer, actually. And so I knew that if we were to have a serious discussion tonight about the nature of jesters, we would have to find a way to get Beatrice here from Switzerland, where she currently resides. Educated in the UK and China, Beatrice has spent the last several years working with the business community, helping develop sustainable business models, thus making a name for herself not only as an expert on jesters, but an expert on sustainability strategies as well. We're very fortunate to have her with us this evening, no doubt with bells on. Friends, please join me in welcoming to the stage Beatrice Otto.
Jesters is that I'm not really a performer by nature, and I just admire them. So I thought I can't be one, so I'm as well study them. So the original idea for this came because I discovered that in China they had jesters, and I got sort of that blew me away because they were just like the Western archetype, the way we think of jesters, kingly school and so on. And that began this idea of, you know, is this a universal role? What is the role and where can they be found? So the title of the book, Fools Are Everywhere, comes from this Latin phrase, which means fools are everywhere. And you can see that encapsulated in this world map. So what I admire about jesters and fools is their resilience. They're incredibly resilient. They're very resourceful. They have great psychological acuity. They think sort of on the hoof. They have to react to people and get people to react very quickly, very spontaneously. So that sort of admiration for them has invested my work. And it was really like this. This was a study of humor done in the 16th century, but this is how I studied. This was my sort of method, was I just turned over every stone I could that had the word fool or jester in it. So I go straight to the bibliography of a book, find everything in there I hadn't read, and start reading. So it was, I did that for 5 years, and it built up quite a nice bibliography. There are lots of definitions of fools and court jesters. I think this is my favorite. It's Rabelais' description of Panurge, and I think it almost covers the full spectrum of what a court jester is. There are a couple of aspects that I have added to this that I think Rabelais just didn't quite get around to mentioning. But I'll use this, if you like, as the structure for the story around jesters. Firstly, the fool as court jester, which includes fool as companion, the fool as goad to the wise and challenge to the virtuous, and the fool as critic of the world. And I love this guy. I just found him online, this rather cool fool. So the fool as court jester. One of the earliest one that I came across that really I think hits all bases in terms of being a court jester is a Chinese jester from the 7th century BC, a dwarf jester called Jester Shu, and he served a duke. And he said, "I am a jester, my words cannot give offense." And that really, you see that right across the spectrum, wherever jesters occur, that they have a certain license to speak very freely. For me, another element that really singles them out from general entertainers or clowns is that they have this very close relationship to the person in power. This is from a 17th century French quotation. The jester in chess, sorry, the fool in chess is closest to the king. And that really symbiotic relationship between, and we use the king, but it could be an emperor, it could be a duke, a pope, an emperor, or whatever. That closeness of them is very important, and it's one of the two things that I think separates them from more generic entertainers. The stone relief you see there is supposed to be of Maximilian I, the Holy Roman Emperor. He had a lifelong court jester called Kunz von der Rosen,
I don't think this is a picture of him, it's a generic fool. What I like about it is it shows the really independent stance of the fool. It's called the fool and the chancellor. And you see the chancellor kind of bending towards the emperor, almost sycophantically, and the jester's looking the other way, doing his own thing. And that it really embodies that kind of independence in them. When I say fools are everywhere, I don't mean every single cultural court at all times, but they were in really most of the major civilizations, and I think many of the smaller civilizations as well, and in India included. And this is a sketch of a stone relief of a stock character in Sanskrit drama called the Vidushaka, who was described as being very much like a court jester. And this is taken from a work on Sanskrit drama. And again, it's this being ready-witted, being able to crack jokes, being able to make the king laugh. And then I think, again, you've got that, the fact that he can give censure through his words. He has that license to criticize and mock even people in power. The relationship, the closeness between the king and the fool, it also translated into all kinds of grace and favor and perks and so on. And this is just two examples from about 400 stories from classical Chinese that I went through with a tooth comb, where at the end, you know, when the jester has made the emperor laugh, he gets a reward. And in China, it makes sense, it would be sort of bolts of silk and so on. Elsewhere, there were lots of other rewards. In Europe, the court account books really give you a lot of insight into how the jesters were treated. And I think there's a kind of urban myth that jesters just slept on straw and were kicked around and treated very badly. But when you read the court account books, and in my case, I read them in English, French, and Spanish courts as well, they were treated pretty well. They were given all kinds of clothes. They were cared for. If they were what is called naturals, people with mental disabilities or quirks, they were often looked after. They'd have somebody working to look after them. And this is Zuniga, who wrote it. He served the Holy Roman Emperor Charles V, and he wrote a burlesque chronicle of the emperor. And he's here talking about the kind of clothes he was given. And this says, you know, I had a gorgeous gown of purple velvet lined with tawny damask. And then on another occasion, the emperor actually gave him his own robe just as a gift. So this kind of care of the jesters in Spain, for example, in court account books, they were often given coal in winter and ice in summer. And one of the Italian ones was given 2 years leave to go home and see his family. So I don't know how many of us can ever get that kind of perk from from our employers. The image is not Zuniga. I couldn't find a good image of him. It's another jester at the Ferrara court called Gonella. This is Will Summers, who was jester to Henry VIII. In some ways, a simple person. He also stayed in the court after Henry VIII died, so he also worked for Edward and then Mary and then Elizabeth I. And you see again that kind of care of the jester extended sometimes to their families. So Mary, in her court account books, 3 yards of cloth given to the sister of Will Summers. So it could include the whole family. This is a nice story where the king says, okay, what do you want? I'll give you a reward. And he says, well, right now I'm okay, I don't need anything. But when I need it, I'll come back to you and tell you what I need. And I think that kind of selflessness of the jesters is quite common. In some cases, they go the other way and they trick themselves into getting something they really wanted. He's also in a family portrait where Henry had himself and his children painted, and Jane Seymour, the queen who gave him the son he so wanted, and Will Summers is in that picture too. The fool as companion, I think this close relationship, if you think, we sort of forget that these emperors, these very powerful absolute monarchs were human beings. They didn't always behave like it, but they were human beings and they were quite insulated and isolated. One of the French jesters, he said to the king, you know, what I would hate about your job is that you eat alone and shit in company. So, you know, they're really sort of lonely people in a way. And the fool would be a companion to them, would be a confidant, And that kind of relationship was very strong. I think partly because the jester usually came from a humble background and was very unthreatening, not a political threat or any other kind of power threat. So coming back to the theme of tonight, I think they operated within a political and power structure, but they weren't really part of those kind of games. A lot of it came through as the kind of standard court entertainment. So many of the jesters, say in China and in Europe, came from a pool of musicians. They might have a musical talent, and that was might be the first reason they'd be employed in court. And then they'd show this kind of capacity to crack jokes and be trusted and be funny and tell the truth. And they would graduate spontaneously, if you like, to being a court fool. That was the case in China. They were often affiliated to the music bureau of the court, and some of them were quite competent musicians. In Europe as well, you had that musical element was very common. You had wandering troubadours, wandering musicians, and we have, for example, in one of the English accounts, where a guy is first listed as Wat the looter, so he played, not somebody goes and steals things, but somebody plays the lute. And then he makes the king laugh and so on, and then next time he appears in the accounts, he's become Wat the fool, so maybe he dropped the musical element and just went ahead with being the joker. In India, there are sort of three real superstar jesters. All of them were historical jesters, but they became kind of legendary, and even now you can find cartoon strips all about them. This is Birbal, who was a jester to the Mughal Emperor Akbar. And I think this is a lovely testimony. When I was melancholy, Birbal gave me everything except more sorrow to bear. And he also interceded on behalf of people, and that was a key role of the jester, was to really talk to the king or the emperor when they were behaving badly, when they were being cruel or harsh or whatever. They would intercede on behalf. It could be on behalf of just one person, or on behalf of the society in general, if there was a kind of crazy policy. I'll come back to that a bit later. So this house is allegedly a house given to Birbal by Akbar. And another couple of the key jesters in India, one was called Gopal and one was called Tenali Rama. And it's very hard to discern where the real jester ended and this kind of legendary mythical fool appeared. Then the fool as goad to the wise and challenge to the virtuous. I mean, people are very aware, and I found this interesting when I was doing the research, is people are very aware of the role of the fool in criticizing and telling, speaking truth to power. They have a kind of instinctive grasp of that. But they also were just plain able to mock people and a sort of mocking pomposity. So it wasn't just attacking cruelty or injustice or whatever, it was just don't take yourself too seriously, and we've heard that this evening. And also I was struck by Rick Gern's comment about a two-way mirror. The mirror is quite a metaphor used with regards to court fools. The picture on the left is from Erasmus' Praise of Folly, where you see the fool is looking at himself. I like the one on the right. This stone relief is in a town called Nördlingen in Germany. And it's basically a stone relief of a jester, and you look at it, and what it says is, now we are two. In other words, when you look at that stone relief, you're looking at yourself. So it's sort of reflecting back to you, your own folly. And you see that also in some of the carnivals, for example, in Germany, in Bavaria, and so on. The fool will come up to you with a mirror and show you yourself, and it's making you reflect more carefully on who you are. In China, one of the key jesters, they often had lovely names. One of them was called Moving Bucket. There were all kinds of wonderful names. But one of them was called Newly Polished Mirror. So this mirror theme is very common, particularly in medieval Europe, but also elsewhere. There's another folk fool in Europe, loads of stories told about him in half a dozen languages, called Till Eulenspiegel, which means owl glass. And there he is on the left-hand side. This one slide is trying to capture the whole relationship between the court fool and religion. And that's a sort of, you know, whole bucket of worms. on the left-hand side, you've got Till Eulenspiegel, but really trying to show the court jester as mocking religion. And they would mock the pomposity of religion, the hypocrisy, and so on. So that's on the one hand, you've got the jester mocking religion. On the other hand, you have this whole tradition, and you see it on the right, I've used that image to represent it, of a holy fool. And there you've got it's in the Buddhist tradition, of a monk tearing up the sutras. But you have also in Russia and in other places, you have this idea of the holy fool challenging religion from within religion. And more complex even than that, you have priests, for example, in Rome, you had priests who were fools, who would act the fool and play the fool. And you had popes who had fools as a kind of jester in the Vatican, in their own court. So it's quite a sort of complex scenario. One of the Roman priest fools, you know, he took a beating because he just went a bit too far laughing at the Madonna and the popes and religion in general. And a sort of 19th century commentator said, you know, if you're in Rome in the 16th century, laughing at the Madonna and laughing at the Pope was not molto prudente. So they sometimes took a beating for going a bit too far. And again, that came through some of the talks we've had earlier. Where is the line? How far can you go? And I'll come back to that a little later in the talk. This is Archie Armstrong, who was jester to James I in England. And he had a kind of ongoing battle with the Archbishop of Canterbury, who was called Laud. That was his name, L-A-U-D. And Archie, you know, do a grace where he said, all praise be to God and little Laud to the devil. So this kind of battle between them went on. And eventually he offended Laud so much that the king finally took action and kicked him out of the court. He got his revenge by publishing this pamphlet, Archie's Dream, sometime jester to his majesty, but exiled the court by Canterbury's malice. And then I love the small subtitle, in relation to whom the odd chair stands void in hell. And then in the end, Laud was overthrown, and he was a very powerful man who was overthrown. And then Archie's comment on that was, you know, changes in times surely cannot be small when jesters rise and archbishops fall. So Archie was a Scottish jester, originally said to be a sheep stealer. So that kind of general mocking role of the jester, I think it's nicely summed up in this German novel called Simplex Simplicissimus. I managed to say that. I can just discuss all foolishness, I can punish all vanity and pomposity, and my job gives me the excuse for that. No one is too great to escape my tongue. But I think there's a more precise role, this the fool as critic of the world. And this is the real speaking truth to power, and it is the key element, along with being close to the person, the key person in power, that for me defines the court jester as opposed to being a general fool or a general entertainer or clown or whatever. There's a lot of comments in China, in Europe, attesting to that role and the license of the jester to mock and criticize and say whatever he thinks. This is a Roman writer, Quintilian. And he mentions, it's interesting, he mentions buffoons, actors, and fools. It's a trivial matter, cracking jokes and so on. However, it's hard to resist, and it can turn the scale of matters in matters of great importance. And in Rome, I'm talking about ancient Rome, actors often took on this, and the image you have there is of a Roman oil lamp showing a mime actor, one of the actors. And they would not do it necessarily as part of a script or a play, but they would just spontaneously improvise from the stage and criticize the emperor or whatever was going on in Roman society. And this also signifies this connection between the actor stepping forward and acting like a court jester spontaneously, you found in other places as well. So an example in England, Richard Tarleton was both an actor and he was jester to the court of Elizabeth I. In the court of Charles I, there was Tom Killigrew, who Pepys describes as actually having a kind of cap and bells and with it the license to revile or jeer anybody by the privilege of his place. In China, actually, you had two types of jester relationship. You had the one-on-one, I've been talking about, that very close relationship between the jester and the emperor. But you also had kind of proto-drama, where a group of jesters would get together and say, okay, what the emperor's doing at the moment is just crazy. We need to put a stop to this. Or the tax he's imposing on the peasants is killing them. So let's come up with a skit. We'll make up a little story. We'll act it out, and we'll get the point across. And this was quite commonly how they communicated with the emperor, and they did manage to change the emperor's behavior. The emperor would recognize what was going on. And you had the same thing in Elizabeth I's court, where, for example, during a masque, a court entertainment, one of the jesters or one of the actors, they would make some pointed, spontaneous comment, and it was no mechanism for getting a criticism across to Elizabeth, because it was indirect. And I think this using indirect method to make a very direct point was very common. In China, they actually had a term for that. You had a term, the word is jian, combined with official, which meant a remonstrating official. As an official, your job is to remonstrate with the emperor. And they took that and they made that into a different term combined with jester, which showed that the jester's role was to remonstrate and criticize. And they had another term which used satire and humor as your means to criticize. So this sort of using humor as an indirect way to get a point across. It allowed them to get through to the emperor, or the king, or the queen, or whoever, where often conventional advice and sending in memorial and begging and arguing and so on wouldn't necessarily work. And they use very similar techniques in different parts of the world. One technique was to really reduce the crazy idea of the king, emperor, ruler, or whatever, to an absurd level by agreeing with it. So I'm not going to disagree with you. I'm not going to tell you that's crazy. They'd go the other way and say, that is just brilliant. That's the best idea I've heard in years. We must do it, and the jester would get really enthusiastic about the idea and take it to a logical conclusion, and then the emperor would say, yeah, right, we'll drop that. So here you have one of the key jesters in China, Dongfang Shuo. He was more than a jester, he was also a Taoist immortal, and he flew away on a cloud dragon, according to reliable reports. But you see, you know, he was given to jests and buffoonery, he would fool around, but he would observe the emperor's mood, and if he found it right, he would speak out in bold reprimand. And the emperor always listened to what he had to say. And I think jesters, one of the things that interests me about them is they walk on the knife edge in terms of causing offense. You are dealing with an absolute monarch who can lop off your head if they don't like what you're saying in many cases. So really gauging that is very delicate. This is just to show it's not just China and Europe. Also, the Aztecs had jesters, and most of the accounts of this relate to Montezuma II, the 17th century Aztec king, where he would have deformed people, and we'll come to that, performing as jesters. And he liked to hear them, and he observed that among their jests they often pronounced some important truth. And again, you see that again and again, that recognition that these guys can tell the truth. And they're not all guys, some of them are women as well. And this is in a 17th century dictionary where they define the word for jester, which is truhanis, among there are other terms as well, but this is one of the key words. And it says they were admitted into the palaces of kings and the houses of the great, and they had the license to say whatever they felt like, even the truth. So it's pretty clearly summed up there. And then I think Erasmus, what's interesting with Erasmus and his praise of folly is he sort of turned the tables on some of the medieval attitudes to folly. And it's a very complex area and very interesting. The fool could be the sinner, the fool could be the person who rejects God, he rejects what is right, he behaves crazily, but the fool can also be the wise one. That dichotomy is somehow they managed to reconcile that. And Erasmus' praise of folly, he went really further and put folly in the pulpit as the voice of wisdom. Whereas a few years before, you had by Sebastian Brandt, The Ship of Fools, which was kind of an anatomy of folly, different forms of stupidity and ineptitude and so on. And then, you know, 20, 30 years later, you have Erasmus saying, no, fools are the wise ones. That's where the wisdom is. And he refers also to these violent tyrants putting up with their jesters, even though they would insult the ruler directly. I think one of the reasons they got away with that and where that license came from, and this is something that doesn't come in the Rabelais definition that I like, is the fool as other. They would have, there are different aspects to what constituted their otherness. Here you've got Klaus Narr, who's a German fool, to four different electors and one archbishop, quite a long life. And he was what they called a natural, so he had a sort of mental deformity or deficiency. And that was very common in Europe. Not so, I wouldn't say not so common. I haven't found examples particularly outside of Europe, but in Europe it was very common that somebody would be found. So Klaus Narr is a good example. He was allegedly looking after the geese in his village, and he did something daft, and the elector was riding through and said, you really are a fool, you come and work for me and come to my court. And it was kind of a form of social care as well. For the family, perhaps a poor family, you don't know what to do with this child, and then a ruler comes through, or somebody representing the ruler, and they take them to court, and they were often very well cared for. But part of this also is there was a kind of belief they might have some kind of hotline to God and you know, be able to really speak the truth. And their simplicity was part of what would allow them to speak the truth. The way we all know, you often see children can sort of stun you with their candor and their honesty and insight. So it was the same principle. And many people affected, pretended to be fools, to have that kind of freedom to speak out. This is actually a contemporary clown priest in England, not the guy hanging upside down, that's from Rupert the Bear. But the quotation is a clown priest who said, the clown stands on his head and sees the world the right way up. So I think also this otherness was having a different perspective of some form. It could be you're from a very humble background and you're surrounded by courtiers from the upper echelons of societies. It could be you have a mental quirk or deformity. It could be a physical deformity. And dwarfs are very commonly jesters, not always. So you might have in a court, you might have dwarfs who live in the court and are cared for and are very close to the ruler, but aren't really court jesters. You might have court jesters who are not dwarfs, and sometimes you get this kind of overlap. This is the first reference to a court dwarf that I've seen, so going back to the Egyptian pharaoh, where a courtier spotted a dwarf and told the pharaoh, and the pharaoh said, bring him to the court so that he can perform the dances of the god, and I'll come back to that, and rejoice and gladden the heart of the king. And this is, the Egyptians had a couple of dwarf gods, and this is one called Bes, B-E-S. So that, I think, is where the dances of the god, it's dancing to the dwarf god. Having dwarfs and also sometimes hunchbacks as court jesters, there was something broader than that. There was also a belief that somehow they could protect you. There was an element of averting the evil eye and bringing good luck. So there was a real appreciation. So it wasn't, you know, we need to help these guys find a job. There was a real valuing of having dwarfs or hunchbacks in the court, and that's pretty widespread. Here you see from a Chinese classical work where it says dwarfs and hunchbacks were always jesters. I'm not sure that's the case, but and having dwarfs and hunchbacks at one side is like keeping company with mischievous children. And the image on the right, the Chinese says little people country. It's basically very old woodcut of a land of pygmies, that's what it means, that was sent to the Chinese court as tribute. One of the jester I showed you earlier, the Chinese jester Dong Fang Shuo, he complained because he said, those guys, those dwarfs, they get the same allowance as me and they're half my size, it's not fair. So, you know, they were cared for and treated well. How much choice they had is another matter. You know, when I say these were sent as tribute, these pygmies were sent as tribute, did they have a say in that? Probably not. So, you know, that's a different matter. So in different parts of the world, again, this is a reference to Montezuma. Sometimes some little humpback dwarfs would be present at his meals, and these were his jesters. And then you see in the tale of the Thousand and One Nights, again, mention of the hunchback whom all this bother was about. He was the Sultan's jester, and the king could not abide him out of his sight for an hour. We have examples, for example, from a 14th century Persian poet saying, you know, what's the world coming to? I don't get access to the king, but the fool is the only one who gets access at any time of day or night. And then in there's a lot of examples, and this is an element where Europe stands out from the rest of the world. There's a lot of art dedicated to jesters, images of fools, portraits of real jesters, a lot of fountains, for example, in Germany showing jesters and fools and so on. You don't really find that elsewhere, not to the same degree. So this is a 19th century painting these are all sketches of paintings of a dwarf. And then on the right you have a medallion made of Triboulet the First, one of the main French jesters. And his scepter, you see the thing he's holding there, he says, I have the insignia of the king, and I'm endowed with the regality of the king. So that interesting juxtaposition of the jester's bauble and the king's scepter, that kind of interchangeability. And in German, the word for the jester's bauble is fool's scepter. So there's, again, that kind of overlap. These are sketches of two paintings by Velasquez, who did a whole series of portraits of real historical court jesters. And the one on the right is called Calabacillas, which means little pumpkin or little gourd. And the idea there is referring to having an empty head, if you like, the sort of simplicity of the fool. This is, again, Rabelais didn't touch on this, but if this is one of the things I most admire about the jester, is their resilience. They really are incredible, and I think that image kind of captures it. You're dealing with somebody very powerful, in most cases, who could have life and death decisions on the instant, and those decisions could be implemented pretty fast. You had to think on your feet like crazy. You may get it wrong sometimes, and you know, the king may, he's Henry VIII, may have a bad day with his gout. This quotation comes from a Victorian book that's a kind of memoir of child, or an idealized memoir of childhood, and it's through the boy's eyes of looking at the clown and saying, you know, these guys, oh, to be like a clown. You know, you're self-contained, your speech is ready, you're incredibly agile, you brave the forces of society, and you always get the best of it. So I think that's a nice summary of that resilience. This is actually Emma Thompson acting as Leo's fool. I saw this performance in Edinburgh. It was amazingly powerful. It's one of the best performances I've seen. And this quotation from Leo's fool, I think, shows the kind of occupational hazard of being a court jester. You know, the daughters of Leo will whip the fool for speaking the truth. Leo will whip the fool for lying, and either way, he gets whipped if he shuts up. So no way of winning. And there are other examples of this. So this on the top, you see this is a Persian work from 13th century. It may happen that a companion of His Majesty receives gold, and it's possible he loses his head. And then you've got the story of the Indian jester, you know, get out of my court. If you were not a clown, I would have had you hanged. So at least it's showing that the license in this case protected the jester. But there are many examples of jesters being kicked out of court. In Europe, they're sort of playful and repetitive stories. I don't know how much historical credence there is in them. It's more like myths of how jesters escape trouble. where they are exiled from the court, you know, with a comment like, don't ever show your face in court again, and then they walk back in with a bucket on their head, and, you know, never set foot in my court again, and then they walk in with kind of big boots with some other earth inside to insulate them. So these tricks they play to get themselves back into the court. The only example I've come across, and it's only one I've come across, where the jester was actually killed, was in China. So, and again, this resilience, they're never apologetic, they never sort of retract whatever they've said. So there are examples in the Chinese accounts of real court jesters being threatened with execution. One was newly polished mirror, and the emperor was about to shoot him with an arrow. And the jester sort of, you've got to have incredible presence of mind. You are about to be shot, and you talk your way out of it. And he cracked a joke and made a pun on his name being a mirror and so on. And the emperor laughed and put the arrow down and didn't kill him. There is only one example where the emperor was very angry because the jester had commented, basically, you're boozing too much, you're not doing what you should be as an emperor. He was killed. And the emperor afterwards didn't help the jester, but the emperor afterwards really regretted and said, you know, he was really only trying to help me and correct me. That's the only example where a jester literally lost his head. But their resilience, and one of the writers I like who talked about this said they're like cartoon characters. You know, they can be stretched and squashed, and they run off a cliff, and you say, oh my God, they fall down from the cliff, and then they're fine 5 minutes later. But there's something real in that resilience, and I always feel it's something we can all hope for. And the fool now, so just sort of wrapping up, the court jester died out in different places at different times, but basically by the, I'd say, 18th century, it was dying out as a regular feature of courts. Still, you could still find it in the Russian court and so on. Court dwarfs probably continued a little bit longer. So I've had to think about what has replaced the court jester in our society. Is there anything that's replaced the court jester in our society? This was an interesting comment in a book on contemporary theatre fools, the idea that the fool has found a resonance in the modern imagination which he's not enjoyed for 400 years. And I think that's true. I think many people respond very, very warmly to fools. Where I think the difference between the fool now in society and in the past is this: there is no longer this real one-to-one relationship. So it's more diffuse as a role in society. But just a couple of examples that I've kind of tried to dissect it in different ways. The court fool, this on the left, is one of the very rare examples I've come across of what you really say is a court jester, where you have a powerful, in this case, Saudi prince, who has, you know, several planes and all kinds of big entourage, and in his entourage he has two Bedouin men whose role is to tell jokes in the style of the traditional court jesters. So it's a very rare, current, fairly contemporary example of what you call a court jester. And then on the right, this was striking when I was doing the research. It was a Swiss colleague who sent me this. It was a full-page advertisement in one of the key serious Swiss newspapers advertising a petition to have a court jester in the Parliament of Switzerland. And they had a little coupon you could fill in and sign your name and send it in. I don't think there was ever a parliamentary jester appointed, but it was interesting that it turned up this full-page advert. And you don't think of the Swiss as generally being that humorous, but that was something. Then also just another example is that there's a genre of theater called Holocaust drama. In the 1960s and 70s, a number of plays were written revolving around ghettos and so on in the Holocaust era. And they have some very distinctive court jester characters. So on the left in this play, you have the man who's kind of negotiating with the Nazis in the ghetto, and then you have this fool character. So the fool is mocking, saying, court, Jew, council, Jew, do you think you can pull us through? And the man sort of says, you know, why do you have to make a fool of yourself in public so you don't fool the public and yourself? And then the one on the right, I mean, I just I like the joke, you know, if my poor parents had known what a useful thing it would be to be baptized, they'd have held me up until I drowned. So that was quite a, for perhaps 10, 20 years, there was this genre of a few plays that came out that had what I would consider court fools. Another type is the corporate fool. I'm less convinced by this. It sort of sounds trendy and cool, but I'm less convinced by it. Famously, BA, British Airways, had a genuine corporate jester. It was on his business card and so on. It was his real title in the 1990s. And his comment after he was fired by the new CEO was the half-life of a fool is 6 to 9 months. So he, when he was in that role, he was indeed told, you go around, you stick your nose into everybody's business, you ask lots of awkward questions. And then when the new CEO came in, somebody said to him, you know, okay, you've been taking the mickey, that's got to stop now. And he said, well, actually, it's my job. And you can't fire me, because if you do, they'll think you can't take it. And they fired him. So that didn't last. And in this book, The Corporate Fool, is trying to show examples. And I was even asked by a management journal to write a paper, which I did, on the possible role of court jesters or jester types in organizational management and so on. And I've not been overwhelmed. I've said to people, if you know of anybody in a company or an institution now that is a kind of court jester role, get in touch with me. I'm not a squeak. So either they're operating so discreetly below the radar that we never hear of them, or there aren't many. I think what I've seen working in so far as I've worked in organizations, is the use of humor in a kind of court jester role, but not really. It becomes, I've seen it used in a way that's part of the politics and part of the sort of positioning of politics, where you're fawning to the person in power, let's say the CEO, for want of a better word. You're fawning and cracking jokes and flattering and positioning yourself. And it can look like, and I've seen those people say, you know, I'm the court jester, ha ha ha. But it really doesn't ring true to me. It's just a sort of political device. And an example I found for me was inside the Third Reich. I was amazed when I read this Albert Speer comment about jokes being used very carefully in the court, if you like, of Hitler, to help him understand inter-party developments. That's not exactly being critical. Speaking truth to power. So this is, for me, a kind of manipulative use of humor to position yourself. That's why I have that question mark. Where I think we have something more convincing in terms of the inheritor of the court jester's mantle or cap is the comedian, the stand-up comedian. Again, their role is more diffuse. They might stand here with a microphone and crack jokes to you, and be criticizing society and be criticizing the power structures. But as far as I'm aware, they're not in the White House speaking directly to Obama or now Trump or whoever. So I think that direct connection has been lost, but nevertheless, I think they have a strong role to play. And again, going back to the Nazi era, and that, because I think that's certainly a very challenging era in which to try and use humor. There were stand-up comedians before the war who really tried to say things from the stage that were pretty daring things to say. So Weisfeldl is one who made a comment when Dachau was being built, and he said, you know, this is this amazing camp they've built, and it's got huge high fences and watchtowers and barbed wire everywhere. And he took it as if they're trying to keep people out. So he said, but you know, I just have to say a word or two and I'll get in a jiffy. And he also made a joke the night after Kristallnacht, when all the Jewish shops and so on were looted. And he walked onto stage with some jewelry and said, do you think I've been asleep during Kristallnacht? And really drew attention to what was going on. Another one mocked the SS and the kind of luxury in which the SS lived. He made a comment about seeing an SS guy get out of a limousine, and he was really warned, like, watch it, you know, don't go too far. And so he went on stage the next night and said, you know, I was told to watch it, I shouldn't say things like this. So apparently it wasn't an SS guy who got out of the limo and so on. So he really pushed the boundaries. And then Werner Fink, the one on the right, He also mocked what Speer was doing in architectural terms, or trying to do in Berlin, and he was actually taken to a concentration camp. And Albert Speer's comment was, "What a shame, you know, I was planning to go to his show the next night to show I wasn't offended." So, bad luck, old boy. You know, so the comedian as court fool, I think, is as near as we get, except for the cartoonist. For me, these are the two entities that have really taken on some of the role of the jester in society. And this is Patrick Chapat, is a cartoonist in the Swiss newspaper, Le Temps, but he also produces cartoons in American newspapers. And this was after the Charlie Hebdo murders, which again shows the sort of dangers of people using humor, where he said, you know, humor really allows us to digest the horror of the world. That's why we're here. That's why we're necessary. Society needs us to breathe. And I thought that was quite a poignant comment on the cartoonist and their role. And again, in the run-up to the war, you had cartoonists. These were done in 1936, were already warning about some of the things that were coming. I think the one on the right is very powerful. It's the it shows Norwegian iron being exported to Germany, and then it says the iron comes back in a different form. So closing comments, just a few comments, and I was struck by the comments Rick made at the end, just sort of personal things that he struck him or that he keeps in mind. And this is the same thing for me. So this quote struck me from Ernest Hemingway's For Whom the Bell Tolls. We are very serious, so we can make very strong jokes. And I think one of the things I see, or I react against in our society, is that being serious often means you cannot joke, you cannot be funny. Humor and seriousness are seen often as being separate. And what is considered serious, I call earnest, where you're sort of super serious. And that to me is a little bit hollow, it's not quite convincing. And I think humor is actually a very serious business. And there was another comment in Lawrence Durrell where he says, only the truly gallant can laugh in adversity. So I think this role of humor as being very serious and allowing us to communicate perhaps better on very serious matters is something we need to emphasize and not confuse seriousness with earnestness. This is another, I happened to read a book about Romania, it was a travel book from the 1930s, and I was struck by this definition of humor. A sense of humor is only a sense of proportion. It's a very simple definition, but it really, for me, it crystallizes what humor can do. And what the jester is doing is trying to bring a sense of proportion to very outsized egos with absolute degree of power, and they're trying to rein that in and just put things in proportion. And then lastly, this is from Umberto Eco's The Name of the Rose. I think this is, again, a beautiful summary. Perhaps the mission of those who love mankind is to make people laugh at the truth, to make truth laugh. And I hope you like the picture. I couldn't believe when I found this guy. So that's it. Thank you very much. Thank you for listening.
Beatrice. I'd like to invite Margaret and Rick to please come up on stage. We're going to take just a couple of minutes here at the end to have a nice discussion with all of you as well. So Rick and Margaret, if you could come up here and join us. Anna's got a microphone there in the center, so if you do have a question, just ask that you line up behind the mic so that everybody can hear you and we can have you recorded as well. And also invite, if you could turn on your microphones there, they're turned off. And also invite our speakers to ask questions of each other, too, if any come up.
Now we can see you. You're that blur.
I have a question for Beatrice. First of all, what country was the jester beheaded, the one you mentioned?
China.
In China? And for the most part, how were the jesters handpicked by the emperors or the various rulers in most of the country? Were they actually handpicked?
That's a good question. I would say handpicked.
Can you use your microphone?
Sorry.
Does that work? Okay. Sometimes they were handpicked by an emperor, but sometimes it could be you might be a duke and you're riding through a village and you meet, let's say, the village idiot, and you say, he is really great character, he's very fun. And you might go back to the king and say, I've met this guy, he said, bring him in. And then he'd become the court jester. So it's very spontaneous and meritocratic.
Hi, thanks to all three of you, but I guess my question is really about clowns, jesters, and fools. We make a distinction. It seems to me that Ms. Otto's notion of jesters and fools, there's a disconnect between that and what we mean by contemporary clowns. And I wonder if you could develop that a little bit. And also in the clown culture, and you represent it beautifully, and I love your comment that you make a child smile. But never, the best thing in the world is to see a child smile, the worst thing in the world is to laugh at a child. I think it's changed for my children's generation. I'm an old man, but they're afraid of clowns because there's this whole history now of the killer clowns. What's his name? I forgot. Benji? What was it? Chucky, et cetera, et cetera. Has that changed your whole industry and the notion of clowning now?
Chucky was actually the scary puppet, but there has been a change in a lot of popular culture. There's been some real evil people who have dressed as clowns. John Wayne Gacy here in Chicago, or in the suburbs here. In fact, the very first show I did was I was at a hospital. It was for this local clown group. And we've been practicing, and the whole thing is clowns play big, play it big, play it big. And I was all excited, ready to go on, and we were waiting to go, and the kids were all in this room. There's a big overhead TV. And right before we went on, the news said another body discovered in the basement of killer clown John Wayne Gacy. Click, okay kids, here's the clowns. And that was literally my first show. And I'd been prepared to just play big as dog's balls, but then I see these kids just, and I had right away learn to have those little antennas be very sensitive and play small and play delicate. So there's been a couple real life incidents. There's been a lot of fiction stuff too. And I differentiate between the fiction and the real life people. The fiction, I actually think some of it's kind of cool. But it's also easy. It's a very easy thing. You juxtapose the innocent and the sinister and woo, drama. But there's real cool tattoo stuff of, you know, skulls with red noses and flaming red hair and, call me crazy, but I kind of like that kind of stuff. Or Krusty the Clown, Shakes the Clown, I thought was a funny movie. So, you know, fiction, I'm 100% for free expression of anything you want to express. And people like being scared in a fictional way, and so if Stephen King comes up with a memorable character, more power to him. What bothers me more is the sensationalization of real incidents. For instance, John Wayne Gacy was an electrician. He dressed as a clown twice a year, dressed as the Easter Bunny, dressed as Abraham Lincoln. He lured those poor boys to their deaths, not by offering candy as a clown or a balloon as a clown, but as a contractor offering them work. But the killer contractor doesn't have the same, you know, thing as killer clown. So it's there in the culture. And there's always been a more violent side. There's Punch and Judy. You look at something like that. That's been there a long time. It seems, I think what's as almost as recent as the idea of the evil clown that people talk about has been the infantilization of clowns. You see a lot of these little porcelain figurines, and they've got baby faces and all that. And I think that's a pretty unrealistic portrayal of clowns, too. And in some way, sometimes I think the darker side is just pushing back against the very infantilization and their sort of commercialization that they've all... I mean, I'm very children-friendly, but it doesn't all have to be that way. And even when you're children friendly, you can be mischievous and have a naughty side. So it's there, and there's, I divide the fear of clowns into two types. There's a real type, and you can see it when kids are scared. They won't exhale. They'll kind of inhale, and their little spot between their eyes gets like this. And if you're a sensitive performer, you respect that. You back off. You look at who their friends are and try to make their friends laugh and get them to ease up through proxy, through their friends. You don't try to win them over directly. And that's very real, and it's not that hard to overcome if you're sincere about what you do and you're sensitive. Then there's the flip side, which is, I'm gonna scare clowns. You know, I saw Stephen King's movie It, and I was like, really creepy, I think clowns are creepy. And there's a lot of that, and I kind of refer to that as getting in touch with your inner bigot, because I think for a lot of people, it's, they don't want to see themselves as being nasty or mean people, but we've all got a little bile on us. We've all got a little mean streak. And they see the clowns dress funny. They have big noses. They look different. Well, we can make fun of them. They're just cartoons. So there's the real fear of clowns, which will be there. And part of that comes about because a lot of people think you just put on makeup and a costume and you're a clown. So a lot of people go into it with garish makeup and they overstep their bounds. And I've encountered the aftermath of that. But like I said, when the fear is real, it's, if you're sensitive to it, you can work with it and overcome it. And a lot of times those kids are the ones who give you the biggest hug at the end because they overcame a fear. The one that's hard to overcome is the people who want to be scared of clowns because they gain some sort of social status from it. So it's a mixed bag. There you go.
I don't know if it was a reporter, Rick, or something on your website that I read where it was a kind of deep ontological point that you actually made where you were talking about people who are dressing up as scary clowns now. And along the way, you said something like, those are not really clowns. Those are just people wearing clown costumes. And I thought about that for a second, and I thought, wait a minute. All clowns are wearing clown costumes, right? But I think what you were getting at was that these are just people putting on a costume in order to do something bad, when there is a real thing it is to be a clown, you think.
Well, the ones who do the purely scary stuff, there was a rash of this last year. It was a mixture of some actual sightings, some copycats, and a lot of urban myth. But they didn't do anything funny. One thing about a clown is that a clown represents your own failure. So you fail big. There's a certain sort of, I'll screw up for you. You can laugh at me because I'm exhibiting the screw-ups that we all have. The people who were doing this just to be malicious didn't really represent or embody any of those kind of psychological characteristics of the clowns. They just put on makeup and they held a knife or something. That, to me, is somebody dressing up as a clown.
Maybe with your permission, I'll ask just one last question to close us out tonight. It seems that one theme that perhaps runs across the evening is the future and what happens when institutions die out or change. And so certainly we don't have court jesters because we don't really have courts in the same way. But Beatrice has suggested that it continues on, maybe on cartoonists or stand-up. And Barnum and Bailey, we know, are closing their shutters as well, and perhaps the notion of a circus clown is going to be changing. But Margaret, it seems to me different when you talk about a language dying, when you talk about the possibility that no one will be speaking these words that have very particular meanings that you try to nuance for us. It's not just a question of Ojibwe tricksters moving into some other institution. It might be that there's something truly gone from the world. Do you see anything that we can do about that?
I know you're toward the end here. I guess the thing that comes to mind is that it would still be there. It's just whether or not anybody hears it. Speaking of famous sort of fools, you have the Lone Ranger in Tonto. Tonto was played by an Ojibwe man from Ontario, and he named the Lone Ranger Kimosabe. Our language doesn't necessarily disappear, but if you don't understand that that means peeping Tom and was actually an insult, you just say Kimosabe and you don't know what you're saying. So, I mean, I think it's a matter of it will be there. Chicago will still be Chicago, Kenosha, Wisconsin, Lake Michigan. It's just, will we forget what they mean, I guess.
Well, as we conclude then, I just wanted to tell everybody that I hope you might consider joining us next week, a week from this Wednesday. We're going to be passing out our annual Humanities Laureate Award, and I'm excited that this is the first year it's going to a group and not an individual. We're going to be giving it to the natives at Standing Rock, who are opposing the Dakota Access Pipeline. And we'll have three members of that community coming to accept on behalf of the tens of thousands of people, really, that are involved in that movement. The woman whose land actually everything unfolded on at Standing Rock, and a couple other central people as well. So we hope you join us next Wednesday. But before that, please join me in thanking all of our guests tonight. These are all Richard Bonser Crunch and Margaret Bowman. Also, Democracy Defined. Thank you very much for joining us tonight. Hope to see you again.